everybody, and thank you for joining us today. I'm Erin Mahoney, VP of Product over here at ISSA, and you asked for it, so we are talking about it. The topic that we hear more than any other topic when we ask about what you guys want to learn, nutrition, and how do we make healthy eating easy for clients? So to tackle this question, we're joined with certified health and nutrition coach, Skye Halliday Wilson, who's gonna help us dive more deeply into nutrition and the behaviors around it. Before we get into it, Skye, thanks for joining us.
Absolutely, so happy to be here.
And we're happy to have you. Why don't you tell us in maybe 30 seconds or so a little bit about how nutrition has worked its way into your world as a fitness professional and what that means for you and your business?
Yeah, absolutely. So I am an ISSA certified personal trainer. So I'm a trainer full time. And as I've worked with clients, I've realized that 1 hour in the gym, it's easy to get in, you challenge yourself, you go hard, but the other 23 hours of your day, and that includes eating all day, what you put in your body, that's really where the hard work comes in. You know, that old saying, abs are made in the kitchen, really is true. And I think with marketing these days, with how many options, how many diets, the amount of social media posts you see, it's hard to know what the heck to eat, when to eat it, how to make it. And I realized that nutrition really is the missing key when it comes to a good, well-rounding training regimen. So I really wanted to make it a focus in my own practice to help my own clients.
I love it. I have not heard abs are made in the kitchen. I feel like I get to hear these metaphors every single time I talk to somebody. The more recent one we had was you can't outrun your fork.
Oh, I love that.
It's a good one, right? But they're all saying the same thing, and it's all a little unfortunate because we probably would love to be able to outrun our own fork. Anyways, so getting into nutrition, just based on your experience with clients, why do you think that nutrition is one of the harder things for our clients to tackle?
Absolutely. I think that clients do a really great job of recognizing basics when it comes to exercise. They can quickly understand why strength training is important, why you got to do your cardio. But when it comes to food, the amount of opinions and ways to eat, I mean, it's overwhelming. If you open up your Instagram app right now and you go to your explore page, you're going to see six different trainers, coaches preaching six different ways to get to your goals. So that's tough. Number one, you have way too many voices coming in. And number two, everybody's body is different. So the way I eat that works for me might be different from you, but we both find success in our own way. So I think oftentimes clients look for that one size fits all, forgetting that we're all individual. We have different heritage, different metabolisms, different ways we like to eat. So it can become very confusing and overwhelming. And then oftentimes clients kind of just throw in the towel thinking, I don't know what I'm even supposed to do here. Let's just go with the first option I see.
Yeah, it's kind of funny because as a former personal trainer myself, it's so impressive to see that, like, kind of a squat is a squat is a squat. Yet when it gets to nutrition, there are almost limitless possibilities of not only what a client should be eating, but the habits around their food as well. So, it's interesting. And what I've also seen in the industry, and I'm happy for personal trainers, is I think historically we've talked a lot about nutrition or thought that nutrition is more about like just the science and the carbs and the proteins. But it's really all these other things around it, like the behaviors and like how you were brought up. So talk to me a little bit about what are those other elements outside of nutrition science that you see are really important for the clients that you work with?
Yeah, absolutely. And Erin, I think you're totally right. I think for a long time, the health and fitness industry has preached, all right, well, get your protein in, eat your veggies, call it a day. But we forget that people are complex and we all come from different backgrounds. You know, for example, I have members of my family who are Norwegian and they love to get together and cook this traditional Norwegian bread. And so if you think about it, okay, they're making bread together. That is a carb, if you want to talk about it, you know, it's a starchy carb. But there's so much more to that food including your cultural background, bonding with your family members, and just the emotional ties to it. So I think people look at food as fuel. And again, that's another one of those sayings, food is fuel, but it's so much more than that. It's also the emotional factors. You know, there's a reason why when we feel sad or stressed out that we reach for that bag of chocolate, or when we're feeling anxious that we skip meals. We look at food as just building blocks, but it is more than that. And so I think part of my coaching and what I like to preach is you have to look at your clients as a whole. They're not machines. You don't put gas in the tank simply to get them to go work out. There's a whole lot of other factors you have to consider. Stress from their job, stress from their outside relationships, how busy they are, how long they're on their feet during the day. All of this factors into how you coach. And so it's really important as a nutrition coach and as a coach who focuses on food that you're factoring those individualized needs in instead of handing them a Google document or a paper and saying, hey, here's your meal plan, eat these egg whites, and then you're going to get a six pack. It's just not that simple.
Yeah, totally. So knowing that it's not that simple and it's not the same for everyone, let's pretend, Skye, you've got a client, they come in, let's say they're 50 pounds overweight, their nutrition is a disaster. What are the first three things that you start looking at or tips that you give them? Like, how do you approach nutrition with them?
Absolutely. So my approach in the beginning is really open. I don't like to make any assumptions about anybody, because just because you're overweight doesn't mean you don't have good habits in place. It could mean a plethora of things. So I always start with a 3 to 5 day food journal. I tell my clients, it doesn't matter what it is. Don't think about good or bad. Don't think about anything. If it goes in your mouth, just jot it down, send it to me at the end of the week so I can start recognizing your patterns. For instance, I was just working with a client who is working so hard. She's so stressed out. And in her food journal, I can tell the days that she's overworked and tired, because you can see the foods. For example, she oftentimes reaches for junk food and sugar when she's feeling overwhelmed. I can also then get a good sense of how you like to eat. You know, some people do better on higher carb diets. Some people do better on higher fat. Some people have no idea what protein is, and it's not in any of their meals. So I like to start kind of just with that building blocks, blueprints of what you're already doing. From there, I always have a questionnaire on what my clients do for work, how often they're moving during the day, their stress factors, whether they're married, have kids. And then I start fitting the pieces together and then making a customized plan for my clients. And the biggest thing when it comes to nutrition is small steps. The cold turkey approach, I have yet to see it work. If you've seen it, please share. But I oftentimes tell clients, let's think about adding one more vegetable to your plate, adding that clean carb, trying to add more protein, and then building from there. And oftentimes those small steps lead to healthier long-term habits. So we're not starting over every 30 days.
How long do you think it takes to for your clients to start making those habits and to start craving the healthy foods and not just the junk foods? How long is that?
Yeah, I think it's really different for everybody. You know, another one of those old sayings is a habit takes 21 days to create. I've seen clients decide, you know what, I'm going real strict and hard with this. In those 21 days, I'm making changes, and I've watched it happen. And then I have clients who it usually takes around 4 weeks before they really start to tune in and make those changes, because it's adding that extra thought to your food. It's deciding when you sit down at the restaurant, do I want to have this very heavy, carb-heavy meal, or do I want to choose something lighter? You know, what am I doing for breakfast today? Am I prepping before I go race off to my crazy morning of meetings? Or am I just running through, you know, a Starbucks drive-thru? Things like that. So I would say, especially when it comes to nutrition, don't let yourself get discouraged by your lack of desire to eat broccoli in that first month you're trying something new. It takes a long time. But the best thing is, once you make that mental connection of when I eat better, I feel better. When I eat better, I perform better in the gym. When I eat better, I'm all around doing something better for my body, then it becomes easier. So I always tell clients, hey, if you fall off the wagon, that's okay. This is a marathon, not a sprint. I'll help you get back on and we'll make those better choices together.
Why do you think it's so hard? I mean, everything that you said is resonating. Why do you think it's so hard for clients when they have like one or two bad days for them to just like get back on that horse and keep going?
I think it's a combination of things. First, I think, unfortunately, in the nutrition world, we associate junk food with guilt. We tie that emotion to food, even though falling off the wagon and having that greasy meal or having that dessert, it's not going to derail you. That one choice will not derail your progress. It's that guilt that kicks in that feeds that cycle of, well, I already ate the cake today, so screw it. I'm just going to have a bad day and get back on tomorrow. That's 10 times harder to do than saying, hey, I had that dessert, you know, at lunch. I'm going to have a great healthy dinner and leave it at that and leave that in the past. On top of that, junk food, our body just craves it. You know, it's marketed and it's engineered to make us want more. That combination of fat and sugar, it makes our brain feel good, but it doesn't
make
our
body feel good.
Exactly. I mean, there's a reason why we all, you know, love donuts, why we all love that junk food. But we have to break that cycle of we can't fall into those marketing ploys and we can't keep feeding into those cravings for that junk, because it's kind of like that green-eyed monster. The more you feed it, the more you want it. So as you're building those habits and making those nutrition changes, the less you make those junk food choices, the less you'll want it. But you're right. It is hard when clients fall off, but just getting your client to that mindset of, guess what? Tomorrow's a brand new day, or your next meal is a brand new meal. This does not have to be the thing that sets your tone. Let's just get back on the wagon and move on. Leave it in the past.
I love it. You know, you've said the word choices and decisions a lot, which is really, it's kind of cool because that means that everyone has the power to eat healthy, really. We're not all shackled to everything, but it also implies that we are making food decisions all day long, all the time, bombarded with the media, bombarded with like the people that were around us. How do you help clients overcome that?
I always tell my clients the best thing you can do is plan ahead. I am the type of person who I like to have something like a protein always prepped in my fridge, whether that's shredded chicken in my crock pot or cooked up ground turkey. So when I get home from a very long day and I'm tired and I'm hangry and I don't want to cook, I can reach for that already prepped food and make a good choice. But at that same time, I understand that not everybody likes to meal plan and prep. I have plenty of clients that say, that's just not for me. That's totally fine too. What you need to do then is make a plan for yourself for that day. Don't wait until lunchtime to when you're starving to try and make a good food choice. Decide up front. If you're going out to eat, you're making that choice of your restaurant before your cravings kick in. If you're too busy to grab breakfast in the morning, you're thinking about making that healthier choice when you get to the office. I think telling your clients that if you are not planning ahead, you're planning to fail. And at the end of the day, we're trying to make better habits. And how do you make better habits? You write out what you're going to do. So it's tough, but I think the idea of just leaving it up to fate of what the heck I'm going to be in the mood for, we have to pull that back a little bit, be stricter in our choices. But again, know that you're in control of what goes into your mouth.
Yes. We, talking to some people over here at ISSA, and about nutrition and our nutritional course. And there's a lot of, research out there about like dieting aside and hangriness aside, as the day goes on and as, you know, just stress in general goes on, your brain gets tired and it gets tired of making decisions and it goes with whatever is easiest. So it kind of makes sense that people will reach for, you know, reach for McDonald's, reach for bad choices if the good choices aren't there because their brains are just exhausted from making these decisions all day. So it sounds like you're trying to help your clients make those decisions in advance so that when they are kind of mentally broken down, it's very simple for them.
It's so true. I mean, nobody at the end of their workday has tons of energy to come up with an incredibly healthy meal that they want to then cook for 2 hours. You know, at least for me, I don't want to play Martha Stewart at 5 p.m. I want to play easy peasy so I can relax and, again, let your brain rest. And that's where it comes, just planning ahead. Even if it's something as simple as I don't want a meal plan, but I'm willing to cook at the end of the night, that means I've already planned to have my healthy ingredients at home in the fridge. I've already planned to set that time aside, and I know I'm going to make it happen. You're completely right. Give your brain the rest. Just set yourself up for success early.
So let's go back a little bit. And so as a fitness professional, so a lot of personal trainers out there know intuitively how to eat healthy on their own. And therefore, they already feel like, hey, I know nutrition. My clients just need to do what I do. Walk me through, like, at what point you thought or you realized nutrition was really important for you to incorporate in your services, and maybe kind of talk about the before and after of what that looked like for you, your business, and your clients.
Absolutely. So in my own personal fitness journey, for a long time, I was making strides in the gym. I was lifting heavier weight. I was able to sustain longer cardio sessions. And then I hit a plateau. And when I say I plateaued hard. I was so fatigued. I was tired. I wasn't making any gains in the gym, and I couldn't figure out what the heck was going on. So I reached out to a coach to talk about it, and his feedback was, you are simply not eating enough and you're not eating the right things. When I got my own nutrition in check, that is when it was a game changer for my own fitness journey. When I was eating the right things and eating enough of them at the right times, now my strength was back, my energy was up, and it just changed the entire way I looked at fitness. I think oftentimes people think what you have to do to get healthy or fit is work out in the gym, and they forget about that food piece. So then within my own nutrition practice, within my own personal training practice, I made those connections that if I struggled on my own as a coach, others have to be struggling too. And I think you're right. Oftentimes personal trainers think, well, I do this, it has to work for you, just follow the leader. It's just not that simple. One size does not fit all. You have to help your clients, meet them where they're at, see where they're at with their food. Not everybody's goal is, you know, shredded six pack. Some people just want the energy to chase around their kids at the end of the day. You know, some people want to squat really heavy, so they need to be eating to do that. So I would say the biggest thing is, even though you yourself might have found success in one way, be open to knowing that being a good coach means you're bobbing and weaving and meeting your clients' needs, not what you want for them.
Yeah, great point. It's interesting. Like we always say, but it's kind of assumed, like you said, food is fuel. And so if you were, it's assumed that, but it's easy to forget that too. We were, a month into quarantine, and you know, I knew, like, okay, I'm stuck at home. I don't walk nearly as much as I used to, like all these things. So I got to eat less. So I was just really eating less, but not really changing the food choices. And I remember I would get up and go for jogs in the morning. And one morning I was like, man, I ran way faster than I normally did and felt fantastic. And I was like, what is the difference? And I realized the night before, rather than just eating less, I was making a really higher quality food choice with the carbohydrates that I was selecting and the protein and stuff like that. And it was just such another reminder that, well, no wonder it's been a pain to wake up and run all these other days, because all I was doing was cutting back on the calories, not really changing the quality of it. So that way, you know, it could impact my performance. And it kind of sounds like that was the same for you.
It's so true. And I think oftentimes we get stuck in those old ideals of, well, you know, if you want to be smaller, eat less. If you want to be leaner, eat less. It's, again, not that simple. Maybe that works for some people being just in a caloric deficiency, but it's pretty universal that for all of us, the more high quality your food is, the better your body's going to respond to it. You know, a calorie isn't a calorie. 50 calories of junk food is not the same as, you know, 50 calories of a high quality veggie or lean protein. So you're completely right. I think that we have to get out of that mindset of depriving yourself, because nobody does well feeling hungry and waiting for that next meal. we need to be fueling ourselves with the right foods that we feel satisfied and strong and ready for the next thing when it comes to our nutrition.
Yes. You know, you brought up calorie deficiency, and I was thinking nutrition for personal trainers has really come a long way. And I said that, you know, we talked about that at the beginning, but also in the sense of like, I don't know, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, it really was, hey, a calorie is a calorie. You got to be in the negative, not in the surplus, just do it. And then we started focusing a little bit more on carbs, proteins, and fats. And now it's evolved even more. So tell me about, like, talk to the people that are watching this. What does a good nutrition plan with a client look like? Like, how do you work that into your business? How does that affect what they pay for you? And how does that affect the interaction style that you have with your clients?
Absolutely. So the first thing I always do with the client, you know, after I've done an assessment for them, we get an idea of what their goals are to accomplish in the gym, is I then ask them questions around, you know, what does your nutrition look like? Because like I said earlier, I'm only with them for 1 hour of the day. The other 23 hours is up to them to propel their goals. You know, the goals that they want to hit in the gym have everything to do with how they're eating. So I always ask questions around that. And sometimes you get clients who are really dialed in with nutrition and they just want to learn how to work out. Great. But more times than not, you have clients saying, oh, you know, I think I eat okay. And then you have to dive a little bit deeper in, okay, what's your version of okay? What is your okay? How is that affecting your goals? You know, where do you want to meet there? And I think oftentimes when it comes to nutrition, people are a little bit more reluctant because, again, it takes a little bit more buy-in. You can show up for the hour of the workout, but those other hours of the day when you have to make good choices and be in control of what you're eating, that's tougher for people. So when it comes to what is a good nutrition plan for a client, I think a good plan is the one that works for that individual client. For example, I have a client right now who her entire goal is reducing her sugar intake, and then everything falls secondary to that. Her biggest thing is, I consume too much sugar. I know it's not good for me. I need to get off that. I have another client who his entire goal is to bulk up. He wants to put on mass. So he's eating a different way. I think the biggest thing is listening and then assessing what they are trying to accomplish and how you can help them get there. It's going to be different for everybody, but I have, you know, very few people couldn't benefit from tips and tricks on how to eat better. I think we can always improve.
Well, this was totally not scripted, but my next question for you was going to be, even knowing that everybody's different and we really have to customize and personalize to the person that we're working with, what are some pretty standard tips and tricks, we'll say three, that you think almost everybody out there could be doing differently right now?
Absolutely. So my first tip that I drive home to everybody is, when you're building your plates, choose your veggies first. The more plants you eat, the better off we're going to be. Plants are so full of amazing micronutrients. They're amazing for you. They help build our immune system, which is so important right now with COVID. So as you're filling up your plate, choose your veggie. For myself, I like to choose two or three because I'm a big veggie gal. If you're just new to it, you know, put that on your plate first. Then choose your protein. So we're picking our veggies, then we're choosing our protein. Look for lean protein sources and then add your carb last. In no way does that mean that carbs are dangerous and we should be eating fewer of them. It just means choose those choices first, and then it makes it easier to fit in your carb, whether you're doing a high carb diet or a low carb. So my first tip is choose your veggies. Second, shop the outside perimeter of your grocery store. That's something my mom always used to tell me as a kid and in college. When you shop the perimeter, what are you hitting? You're hitting produce, you're hitting protein, meat sources, fruits and veggies, and then things like dairy, eggs. Everything's refrigerated. Everything has a quick shelf life. The fewer preservatives and ingredients in your food, the better. You know, you head to the middle of the grocery store, what do you have? Your processed foods that when you flip around that nutrition label, you got a whole list of ingredients and it expires in 2025. Okay. Not our best choices. We want to limit those choices. So that would be my second Second, tip and trick. And then third would be plan ahead. Don't wait until you're hungry to make a good choice. Like we were talking about earlier, your brain is not wired to make a good controlled nutrition choice when you're hungry. You know, our bodies want to keep us alive. And when you have those true hunger cues, the first thing you want to do is eat. Don't leave it up to chance that at that time you're going to be craving a big plate of veggies and lean protein. You're probably not. So plan ahead.
Yeah. Perfect. So choose your veggies first, which is a new one. I like that one. It also makes sense. What I try to do is when I am eating my food, I try to eat my veggies first. I love vegetables. I love them, but I also love the other salty, bad stuff.
Exactly.
So when I eat that first, I want more of that instead of more of the veggies. Yep. So I love the eat the veggies first, shopping the perimeter. It's kind of amazing. I try to shop the perimeter too. And every now and then when I go in the middle, like some of the stuff that they have available these days is like crazy. No wonder it's so hard for people to make good choices. <Yeah. laughs> Like, they make that? That's insane.
And the marketing for it, I mean, marketers are smart. They are not dumb. They're playing right into, oh my gosh, that sounds good. You know, what do you mean it's a mega stuffed Oreo dipped in chocolate? That sounds great. That's of course what I want. So if you are shopping primarily in those aisles, that's what you're going to end up with in your cart. If you stick to the perimeter of the grocery store, your food has a shelf life. Fewer preservatives are better for you, and you're making more whole foods choices, fewer ingredients, and it's just better for you all around.
Great. I love all those tips. So thank you so much for joining us today. Is there any parting words of wisdom that you would love to tell some fellow personal trainers out in the field as it relates to nutrition?
I would say stick to the basics. I think you're going to have clients coming through your doors saying, hey, I just read about this new special diet, or my friend is on this diet and she's lost 30 pounds, or this post on Instagram. Basics are basics for a reason. Like we talked about, veggies on your plate, lean protein, eating enough, drinking enough water. Whatever type of client you have, even though you need to customize nutrition for them, everybody benefits from the basics. So don't let it get too complicated. Don't get bogged down in the details. You know the best building blocks. Just present that in a customized way to your clients and stick to it. You know, nutrition is definitely the marathon, not the sprint. You're in it for the long haul, and just help your clients make those sustainable long-term choices so they stay healthier longer.
Great. Thank you, Skye, for joining us. And again, for those of you that are watching, thanks for joining us. Don't forget, you can learn more in the ISSA nutrition course, and be on the lookout for Skye. She's part of our ISSA family. So thank you, Skye.
Absolutely. Thanks, Erin. Have a great rest of your day.
You too. Bye-bye.